हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू संडे शॉर्ट्स. सो आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम ऑल ऑफ माय व्यूवर्स ऑन माय शो टुनाइट. सो यू सीन दैट फाइनली अनलॉकिंग ऑफ इंडिया हैज स्टार्टेड, बट वी हैव नॉट वॉन द वॉर येट अगेंस्ट कोरोना. सो आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू टू स्टे एट होम ओनली एंड ओनली गो आउट इफ दैट्स मोस्ट रिक्वायर्ड. सम स्टेट्स एंड सिटीज आर स्ट्रगलिंग टू मच. लाइक आई लिव इन मुंबई एंड आई कैन से दैट सिचुएशन इज वेरी ग्रिम. So it's better to be safe and follow all the COVID norms, like maintain social distancing, don't go out much, wash your hands, don't order food. So let's start our Sunday night. And tonight's topic is quite interesting. Has innovation stopped in financial and education industry? So first of all, I would like to invite, welcome my guest for tonight, Mr. Harpreet.
Hi.
Hi, sir. Mr. Harpreet, just to give you the kind of background which he carried, is like he is the co-founder and CEO right now at Virshura Shiksha Service Private Limited. It's a one-stop shop for financial solutions for K-12 schools and colleges. He's an innovative strategic entrepreneur and angel investor. I'm the Baz alumnus with around 25 plus years of experience. With me tonight, Amardeep is there. Amardeep is IIM alumnus as well, with 15 plus years of experience. He's a serial entrepreneur, growth guru, and among top marketing gurus globally. And as you know that I'm Suraj, I'm running these days a digital transformation company called The Wisdom. So let's begin the discussion, okay? So in this, along with unprecedented human toll, COVID-19 has triggered a deep economic crisis. The global economic impact could be broader than any that we have seen since the Great Depression. I was going through the McKinsey report, and it was predicted that it's a very deeper economic contraction of around 8 to 10% for fiscal year 2021. This could occur if the wire flares up a few times over the rest of the year, necessitating more lockdowns, causing even greater reluctance among migrants to resume work, and ensuring a very slow recovery rate. So let's begin the discussion with asking Mr. Harpreet that tell me that what in your opinion, what's the impact of COVID-19 on financial industry, first of all?
Okay, first, I thank you for this opportunity on Sunday Shorts, Suraj and Amardeep. I think as the financial services is totally linked up with the economy, you know, and financial services have two legs of it. One is credit, which we give loans to the people, and other is surplus, which we deposit as a liability. So these are the two legs of financial services. And clearly, we need to understand the economy, where it is. So if you see that only healthcare, pharma, grocery business, this was functional during the lockdown period. So, and of course, agriculture was still happening to some extent. So these are the few sectors which are not impacted with the COVID-19 issue. But on the other side, because of lockdown, what has happened is it has stopped all the economic activity in other sectors. So obviously, there is a huge impact. And if you see the job loss data, which has been published by CMIE, the job losses estimated are 12 crore people have lost jobs, okay, in this April month. And unemployment rate has gone up from 7.8% in February to somewhere around 27%. It has now improved in May because of a small lockdown getting removed in various industries. But that is the situation. Because of this, what has happened is financial services have come to the totally kind of a halt, except the liability side, which is a deposit side. So deposit size has improved because not many people have taken away their cash for expenses. So except food expenses or little bit of education expenses or rental, nothing else has happened as an expense, which is a discretionary in nature. So which has increased the deposit size of the balance sheet. And obviously, government has pumped a lot of liquidity into the system. So enough liquidity from in the banks currently, and so impact on that side is, I think it is expected that there will be rise in little bit of NPA definitely because of job losses. And the good thing RBI has done is they have given 6 months now moratorium to the people, so that people, SME businesses can come back, MSME businesses can come back to the business. So that is a positive. But on the negative side is NPA may go up because some of the businesses may have wiped out because of small capital with the small traders. That is possible. But good thing, another good thing which government has done is they have given 3 lakh credit guarantee to the MSME sector, which has already got loans. So when I have spoken to few MSME people, they have got some part of that credit guarantees already with them, and they are finding this will definitely give some relief to them.
This is very surprising in some ways, because people were expecting the NPAs and, you know, deposits to come down, you know, deteriorate further. But this is a very, welcome news that actually the deposits have increased and during this period, which is very surprising and which is very good for the financial industry as such.
Yeah, I think the cost of fund will go down. And that's why if you see, RBI had taken action, 40 basis point cost cut was there already by reverse repo rate has been dropped. So that definitely improves the cost of funds for the industry. But it has not yet been passed down to the industry as yet, because it takes time for industry to pass on this, banks and financial services companies to pass on this. It will take about 3 months to maybe 6 months time.
Ajay, on a related note, the 20 lakh crore package which the government has announced, okay, what impact of that do you see, particularly on the financial industry?
So I think I told you that out of that 20 lakh package, some part is about 1.5 lakh crore package is direct given to the poor people, where they can get some money into their hand. That is only direct credit which has happened. Rest is all either credit guarantees or money given to RBI for further lending to NBFCs. Okay. That is helping the financial services industry per se. But unfortunately, that has not gone down deep into the smaller NBFCs. And that is where the struggle is lying. The smaller NBFCs are getting hurt. Larger NBFCs who have good credit ratings above AA+, they don't have any issue. They have enough liquidity. But as soon as you go down, BBB- kind of credit rating companies have an issue in accessing the credit. And that is where RBI is working with the banks to ensure that they also get some credit. So overall, 3 lakh credit guarantee scheme to MSME plus this 5 to 6 lakh crore given to RBI will definitely improve the liquidity. But I think somewhere there is a need of fiscal help to be given to some of the sectors, definitely, like hospitality sector, hotels, airlines, travel agents. All the whole industry has gone into really big troublesome time, and it will take some time to come back. So it will take another 3 to 6 months time to come back to some semblance of break-even kind of a situation. So they may need more fiscal benefit, and startups, I would say. So these are the two categories. They will need some fiscal benefit if government can come with a fund where the fund can directly take some equity into the startups and help them with the capital, because they don't have too much capital to last for 2-3 months of lockdown.
I got you. But,
related question,
Suraj, I'll just, build on that. Sorry to, butt you in there. But so in the bond markets, there was already a provision of some 50,000 crores, which the government did in the beginning of the lockdown. But apparently the uses of that fund and, people taking, that credit facility that was pretty less. Some, you know, it was less than 5% or something. That's what I read somewhere. What's your take on that?
Yeah, you're right. Again, it is offered, again, these bonds were offered to the, again, AA plus companies, which already have adequate cash on their balance sheet. So they don't need this. So obviously, you know, you're giving some fund, which is where they have changed the methodology now. RBI has changed this and gone back to the banks and said that this can be given to the lesser credit rating company. So they are talking, but currently I think still NBFCs are in trouble.
But don't you think so that if they dilute the provisions and go down further and, you know, maybe say, you know, triple B plus or something like that and go down even further, what will happen to the, you know, there can be a problem of NPAs going ahead?
Yes, so that is where the struggle of banks are, that if they go down to this route, supporting NBFCs, then there is a chances of higher NPAs coming up. But I think personally, if you ask me, I think the kind of funds they will give versus what will happen to the economy is much better. So it is better to provide this funding, and you will have to, as an economy, we will have to live with higher NPAs. There is no doubt about it. We hope that these NPA will recover. See, some of the markets where it is secured credit, you will not get hurt over the period of time. But yes, where there is a unsecured credit, definitely that will have a huge impact. So even if you may have, like in banks, when we had the demonetization, I can tell you, I had handled balance sheets in 2007, 2008, the similar situations or demonetization, you know, your NPA goes up for some time. And then slowly, as the businesses come back to their shape within 3 to 6 months' time, people start repaying it. So your net NPA over the period of 6-8 months come down. So it may have a bulge at one point of time, but it will come down. This time it has been a little different because some companies or some smaller people would have lost their capital altogether, and they would be kind of a bankrupt kind of a situation. So that is where worry is, that how many businesses have gone out of the business altogether.
Gotcha. Okay.
One question is coming from Devendra Mehta to you, Harpreet. Do you think that government should force banks on getting the information of implementation, as it is important?
Yeah, the whole information actually comes. There is a regular system of RBI. Whenever they launch any program, to the banks, they get information from every bank, what is happening to this 50,000 crore, which you just talked about, that they are seeing that the utilization is less. But in the last 10 days, I think utilization has gone up. The first 1 month, it hardly budged, as Amardeep said, 5 to 7%. But over the period of time, I think RBI will come down slightly on the banks. See, they have more say on the PSU banks. They have very little say on the private banks. So PSU bank may be the one who will take the baton forward and pass on this to the NBFCs. Normally, they are the one who do this.
Okay, I got you. But, you know, you talked about the 3 lakh crores. You talked about the 50,000 crores. Where do you see this uptake is coming? So where are people taking more money, and you know,
So I think 3 lakh crore will definitely help all the MSMEs. I think there you will see some uptake happening there. I would say that will be a bigger uptake. And some SMEs were expecting some kind of, though the government has also given some help to some smaller industries where they have employees, where they picked up PF cost also. About 6,000 crores of worth of PF cost has been picked up by the government in the last 6 months' time. So these companies who have 100 employees, less than 100 employees, and who have employees less than 15,000 rupees per month payment, they will also get positive impact from the government point of view, because the PF will not be deducted.
So, you know, this is very interesting. You're an investor also. I'm also an investor. You know, what do you see in your, you know, the companies in which you have invested? Is the process of taking a loan, you know, is it very easy? what are, you know, many times now there are these big grand plans, but they kind of fall short when it comes to, you know, some of these kind of implementation, that governments are creating too many issues, or, you know, maybe the governments want it to happen very, very badly, but the banks, etc., they create so many issues that, you know, it becomes impossible for a, you know, like an investee company or a small company, you know, startup to finally avail the offer.
I agree. So what they have done is, I think that's one good thing government has done is they have said that immediately if you have already credit availed from the bank, so you have taken some loan, on the top of it, they are giving 20% of the additional loan. So that I have checked up with people, they have got 10% already. So they are expecting that next 10% may also come down to them automatically. So they have increased the credit lines to the companies, definitely. So there is a pass on happening. But to new people, I think that is going to be a tough one, because they want you have to be solvent at any point of time. That means your business has to be running profitably. Now, to prove that, not many startups will come into that play. And that is where the problem is. In the startups, will get hurt quite dramatically. The businesses who are doing okay and they've got additional money, they will survive and they will take the help of this additional credit. And they are getting it also.
My next question is related to startups only, Harpreet. Okay, what will happen to the fintech startups which have just started? Okay, because global economy is struggling, and what will happen to them? Your thoughts on that?
Okay, so fintechs, you know, by per se is a digital platform companies, basically in financial services. So they will face. So there are two kinds of issues they are going to face. One, a lot of these fintechs are new. In the last 3 years, they have come up in a big way. So some of them who are well funded will not have big issues. So the NPAs will increase because they have lent on a certain particular credit score. They have developed their own scores by taking social media into account and some other and also bureau scores. They have done some multiple of that and new to credit, basically new to business. They have given loans to them. So what will happen is the companies which are not well capitalized will definitely have issues, going to face issues during this time, because their NPAs will increase quite dramatically, especially in unsecured market. And while in the case of fintechs in the well-funded, who have, I've heard that there are quite a few fintechs who have raised capital just before COVID announcement. So they are well-funded. So they will escape the brunt of this, because they will have enough capital to lose even if the NPAs increase over the period of time. And as I told you that hopefully the economy...
Don't you think it is related with the, I mean, it is going to stay for long, I mean, and don't think so. Amardeep, you can also add on after Harpreet, okay?
So I think if you see the China, I think China is the only country which has come back after the COVID thing. So people are seeing that model, that if China can come back, and I was just hearing today in the TV that 80% of their production is back, okay? And they are running full capacity. Even services have also come back. So manufacturing came back first, and now servicing is also coming back. So if that is, and we are talking about financial services, if that is the situation, I think slowly, if the economy takes off well, which is expected that it will take maybe 8 months to 12 months time. And if that happens, then I think you will have lesser NPA issues at the end of 1 year. I will not say that in immediate there will be bulge, but over the period of time you will see that it evening out. As the people get their money into their pocket, they will start paying it.
So I you know, Suraj, I feel that see, the number of people we are still a small economy. We are not real, like a really large economy. let's not fool ourselves, okay? But we have got a young population. So young population cannot be silenced. They have to move forward. They have to do new jobs. They have to do, be employed, all of that. They will do all of that, okay? And nobody can stop that force. So I feel that, from a roughly anywhere between $2 to $3 trillion economy, which we are today, we have a lot of scope and a lot of room to grow. That's where I feel that the resilience of India, the moment this lockdown is over, and you know, this small dip to a very large degree is a bit of a dip which we are seeing because of the corona condition, lockdown, you know, so there is a demand supply mismatch, all of that is happening. And hence that there is this. But the moment this starts kind of opening, and you know, which is 1st of June, we are opening, 15th of June, there will be more relaxation, 30th of June, even more. So you will start seeing that a lot of pickup will start happening. And you'll also see that, you know, a lot of these smaller issues like migrant crisis and all of that, they will also start kind of falling into place. They became very big because, you know, it was like a forced thing. Like you lock somebody in the home. If you lock somebody in the home, then there will be all kinds of trouble. But the moment you open him, there will be, you know, a phase thing which will kind of come into play. I completely agree with Harpreet there that we should be up and running in another max 3 months time.
Correct, Pradeep. Sorry, I'm butting in.
Sure.
Demonetization has told us we have gone through this phase where again migrant labor went back to the villages, and finally once the job creation started happening, they will come back. See, auto guys have come. You know, let me give you who are the migrant labor. A lot of auto guys went away because there were no autos in the taxi guys went away. So all these kind of people who were from outside doing these jobs, and some of the manufacturing jobs had gone up. So anyway, manufacturing companies will also take time to build, and they are also releasing auto and taxis also slowly. So what will happen is that 2-3 months which we are talking will take time to come up to some level of 40-50% of running proper manner. I think by that time, these guys will come back. See, finally, there is no jobs in villages. Let's understand that. And they will have to come back to earn their bread. See, why they have gone back? Because they were getting worried. The families at the home were getting worried that, oh, Bombay has so much of crisis. Delhi has so much of crisis. So they don't want any of us, if we have a son or a daughter there, we would be worried and we would like them to see one time.
Correct.
And that's where the full flights have gone. So I think some people have traveled on flights, they have gone on foot, and they have gone on trains. So that's the way I think it will come back. So personally, I feel it is a matter of 6-8 months time. Things will be much better. Yes, there will be losses. I'm not saying that there will be some businesses which will never come back. But another good thing is agriculture is quite okay of country. So, you know, 60% of employment is in the agriculture area. So only which is getting more impacted, if you ask me, are the metro jobs and little bit of tier one cities. Because I run school, I give a lot of finances in the schools. And I can tell you that my 70 to 80% parents are farmer related. And they are not that impacted on their cash flow basis. So only vegetable crop farmers have got impacted because their vegetables were not transported to the cities. The transport was not available because of the lockdown from one city to another. So they lost huge amount of money. You might have heard tomatoes being sold at 1 rupee or being thrown away. All that is a true story in some pockets where the vegetable growers lost money. But as far as Ravi crop, which is there, not many people have lost money because they have been picked up by mandis, by the government agencies quite well.
So on a related note, Suraj, I've got a bit of a suggestion here, and that is actually so while we both agree that, you know, there is going to be a recovery, there is definitely going to be a shortfall, and our GDP growth rate numbers are going to come down. They might even be slightly negative. Okay, we should be, you know, aware of that situation. Also, see, there are two things which are happening. We are right now seeing, because of lockdown, an artificial, shortage in both supply and demand. But, you know, the moment this lockdown is kind of getting open, we're going to see more and more demand happening. And this demand will peak in, say, another 3 months, another one quarter to, you know, 1.5 quarters. The demand will peak, and then all of a sudden you will see a supply crisis happening. So it should hit us somewhere around 3-3.5-4 months down the line, because for 2-3 months there has hardly been any production in India. So until and unless, you know, with the import-related stuff, you might still be able to kind of put it together because China and all they are supplying. But the homegrown stuff, you might see some kind of an issue. Okay. Agriculture, as you know, Harpreet pointed out that agriculture may be, you know, kind of be able to maintain if this locust issue does not become very big. The locust issue is a bit of a challenge there, but otherwise it looks fine.
So now, locust is also not a big deal, Amardeep, because the crops have been cut already.
Yeah.
So that's the beauty of it. If it would have come a month earlier, I think we would have been in a serious issue.
I agree that
locust came after cutting off the crop. So damages will be there, but not much.
I had a suggestion that, you know, Government of India, and this is like slightly out of the box suggestion, because there is going to be a bit of a demand and supply mismatch for a while, you know, and I think it should extend for at least 2 quarters. The government may look at infusing some direct liquidity by printing currency. I believe that we should do some amount of an opposite of demonetization, because we have given 2 monetary shocks to the economy already in a period of 2-3 years. One first shock happened due to demonetization, where all the money was sucked in for 4-5 months. And then again, this shock has come in when all the money has been sucked in. What has happened is, because of that, Indians any which ways like to save more, spend less, at an overall basis. And this is going to kind of further fuel them, further force them to, you know, not spend too much. Now, if you do a small injection, and I would go with what Raghuram Rajan said in one of his interviews, that, you know, 65,000 crores, which is the kind of money which is needed by the migrant laborers to, you know, kind of for them to survive. If the government prints that money and directly gives that money to the bottom of the pyramid, I think it's going to spur a lot of demand, because they have money they're going to spend, which is going to, you know, kind of initiate that chain reaction. And that is going to push them faster into jobs, because companies are going to see a lot of demand happening. And hence, they're going to kind of put everything behind production. And when they put everything, they're not going to haggle over, 2,000 rupees for an employee kind of a cost. So they're going to hire in more numbers, and which might kind of, you know, streamline a lot of things for us. So this is like a suggestion which I had, I don't know what Harpreet thinks about it.
No, I agree with that. I think fiscal benefit at this point of time in the hand of especially this, the bottom of pyramid of about a few thousand crores, which you talked about, I think will definitely help the spur the demand faster, you know, and that will bring our economy faster on the track. So personally, I feel if this is given back, I think it will spur the economy. So finally, it is money. Money will rotate. So once the money rotates, it will get into the hands, and the government itself will normally 1 rupee spent by us. Somebody has calculated if we put all the taxes, we only save 70% goes back to the government, actually, in some form of the tax. Okay, so I think the money will be going back into the hand of government again. So it makes sense to have this kind of, only thing I think government is not doing it currently. The reason is, I think they don't know whether they have all the accounts of the people. So they have only done, Janadan accounts, but they need to have more, some of the accounts like migrant laborers. I don't think they have database of that. That's why they are resisting to give cash into the accounts. That is where I think there is an issue. But they should give, in my mind, wherever you have accounts, I think we should give that money. And it will come back to the government in the form of taxes,
I agree with you. But, you know, so there is this dilemma that should government, you know, so government can give money, but they will have to kind of take the money from the planned expenditure. And hence, you know, our fiscal expenditure in other heads kind of will go down. So that is one way. The other way is that government prints money and, you know, says that, you know, I'm printing this special 65,000 crores for giving to these people. And, you know, they go ahead and kind of give it. Which one do you think is the better route?
So whenever you print money, it will increase the inflation, definitely. So that is a worry of, but it is a short period of time. Anyway, our inflation is now in low numbers because there is no demand. So absolutely. I think at this point of time, printing of money, we should not hesitate from printing of money and giving back to the industry. That's what US has done. US is also printing money and giving it back.
They print money left, right, and center for everything.
So they don't have fiscal consciousness. I think that is what a lot of people are saying. And I agree with that, government. But I think somewhere we are too conservative on the one side of the pendulum. So if America is on the one side, I think we are on the other side. So I think somewhere in between, we have to find a path which can spur the economy.
I agree. The only, the pointers which I'm seeing against this are that, you know, once you do it, it kind of becomes a habit. Because, you know, then you know, you cannot kind of, for every little problem, the first solution is start printing money and give it to people. Because the moment you give money to people, people become very happy. And this, everything can be then corrected with the use of money. This is normally what happens. So,
Amardeep, this is an unprecedented time. I think we cannot have this habit kind of thing. Already, the government has been quite fiscally prudent, I would say that. And that's a criticism they are going to have, that they haven't yet given that fiscal benefit of this 65,000 crore in money to the people. So they are prudent people. And I think RBI is also helping government to handle on the cash. They have given special drawdown limits to the states and to the central government. So I think giving a little bit of money into the hands of people will only help spur the demand. Maybe, who knows, you may see some fiscal benefit coming through in next coming days. Nothing is what people say. Nothing is closed at this point of time. They are taking step as they see the economy coming up.
Got you. I think a very fair point. Suraj. I think Suraj's screen is frozen.
Hello. Yeah, there is some network issue going on. Okay.
No problem.
I think I am audible to you guys. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yes. I'm just reflecting some questions because that are coming from the viewers. Okay. So.
Yeah. This is what I think. We said that.
Suraj, we can hear you. You can speak up.
So I think the question is on the education. Basically, what they are talking of, one of Sushmita Ghosh has put in that question, that during this time, now digital education is happening. So there was a skill gap which was there on getting the jobs. Will that help to fulfill? I think yes, definitely. We have seen as a company, Vasura Shiksha, we also sold a lot of online media learning management system to the schools, because suddenly school learning came to the halt and they were not getting fees. Actually, schools were not getting fees. Once they got this learning management system, they started getting fees, and there was a high court verdict also finally that online learning is as good as going into the class. Finally, that verdict has helped the school owners to get their fees from the parents. Okay. So coming back on the skill side, I think there's a valid observation that digital media, usage of digital media on skilling will definitely help getting more jobs. And some of the skills now which industry needing is AI skills, which can be imparted on the computer. My son, who is doing his internship in computer science with the AI company, and he's been working from home and quite successfully. So same way, these skills can be imparted online. So most of the jobs which are there in this part of the skill set, IT part of it, definitely can happen on the on the online basis. But yes, there are some skills like machinery or carpentry that can happen only on the job, in a training program, ITIs, which are there in the country. So that will continue to do that. But some part of the skills definitely can be done on the job, on the online basis.
So adding on to, you know, what you're saying, I see in education, there are these six kind of innovations which are kind of bound to happen. First thing is this whole virtual reality. Other is artificial intelligence and machine learning. A lot of cloud computing for education, which is kind of bound to happen. 3D printing, you know, should also come in. And social media in educational institutions being promoted. And a lot of this education over an app or education over this thing, which is kind of as as good as, or maybe even better. That's the whole point which I keep on saying, that, you know, when people thought that buying from Amazon or Flipkart was going to be as good as buying from a shop, actually they went ahead and proved that it is actually better buying it from them, because you can return it, you get it at your home, and so on and so forth. In the same way, the education industry may kind of evolve in making sure that study at home or study remotely is actually better than studying at a school. Now that is a very interesting thing, and that's where I'll pose a question to you also, Harpreet, that do you think that the future of the physical schools is in some kind of a danger in, say, next 1 to 3 years?
So I don't think so. Physical schools are going to extinct from the earth. Okay, that is not going to happen. The simple reason is there is lot of you're back. We lost you. So coming back, I think the learning has a multiple dimensions to it. One is a classroom learning, which can happen through online also. That is true. But for that, we have to first train online teachers. So, you know, suddenly you find that teachers are not, they are not trained to teach on online basis. So you can say, some people were telling me that the teachers are exposed to the parents now, because earlier you had gone only to meet your class teacher or maybe subject. Now everybody is on the online, and all parents are seeing who is teaching what and how is their knowledge. So that is one. Clearly there is a deficit on that side, and it will remain as a hybrid. So I would say that, to answer to your question, there will be a hybrid solution. Some part will be online, some part will remain as a physical, because in physical you learn how social, you are a social human being, is a social person. So they learn other skills of how to interact with each other, how do you have emotional bondage is there with your friends. You get all the your friends if you go back, either in the schools or in colleges, right? If you see your WhatsApp group, it is full of either school friends or colleges. Very, very little of your business guys. You know, they are more of a colleagues or good business acquaintances, I would say that. So these are, and then play, you know, whether it is a football or cricket or whatever games you learn in, and that's where you work team skills you learn. So there are a lot of learning of various other skills which school helps to develop. Okay, consciously or unconsciously, both. Okay, and communication skills. So I think there will be a hybrid model. I don't think one model will override the other. Rather, I feel there may be needs for more classrooms if this social distancing is going to happen. So what may happen is the schools will have to get more and more number of classrooms, so that if this kind of viruses come and go kind of a thing, so you may have larger classrooms than what we have currently. So who knows, we may have more bigger schools than what it is. But it is too early to say, comment on that. But if there is an event like this, another 1 year later, another virus hits us, definitely people will start thinking that we have to have a bigger schools, bigger college, to have social distancing happening in the school. I feel personally this year, class 1 to 5th in the cities, may not open ever. They may not open at all if the COVID remains. Okay. While class 6 to 12th, there may be schools operating with the social distancing, with the alternate days or whatever mix of thing. So that will be there.
I think you have answered Mr. Sunil's question, because he was asking the same question. Do you think that online teaching could replace classrooms in time to come? Thanks, Sunil, for your question.
And also, also the mobile, getting, I'm hearing this from the, we deal in tier 2, tier 3 cities. So the number of mobiles available at home, which are smartphones, are not many. In the sense, you need at least one smartphone. Today, the smartphone was available because father or mother were there at home. But if they have only one mobile, which is maybe a smartphone in tier 2, tier 3 cities, so suddenly you may find that there is a deficit of smartphones. There may be a choice that smartphone may increase, phone sales will increase, and then in tier 2, tier 3 cities, then you can have education in the, you will have some part of education going through on online basis.
But then the smartphone penetration, any which ways, is pretty high. And so I have two, three observations here. Okay, so one thing is very clear, that the professional courses route, there is going to be a big domination of the online industry. They have already kind of taken a lot of leap there. And, I see that, that area, the physical institutes will have a lot to kind of compete there, because there is going to be some kind of an academy, all of them. Their primary market is to actually attack their professional courses. Now, the point is, and it is kind of two, three fold now, that one, if this situation kind of remains, especially with the younger children, and, which are between, say, nursery to class 5, if they're not going to kind of go, what impact will it have, one, on the funding for this sector, and how do you see your company kind of playing a role there? And secondly, how do you see that these schools, the impact will happen on the overall real estate prices, especially commercial real estate, because a lot of these are operating from commercial real estate, and if they get all of a sudden that space becomes empty, which we are talking about in large numbers, how does it impact the whole thing?
So you're right that class 1 to 5th, if it continues for longer time, I think this year it's going to be, in my mind, this is going to be there. So there will be huge online requirement from that point of view. So what will happen with social distancing required from class 6 to 12th will be completed by these 1st to 5th class. So if the 1st to 5th class is not there, so they will sit into these classes with having a social distancing. So infrastructure of school will get full. But it is empty on the other side, but it is full from the other side. So if the balance of the classroom is same, like you have equal sections in both the 1st to 5th and 6th to 12th, then it is okay. Otherwise, you will fall short of classrooms, point number one. Point number two, what I heard also is that government is thinking of reducing the curriculum this time by about 20-25%. Okay, so that is also a possible solution to that. And so that will help the school to complete their curriculum faster and with the smaller thing. But yes, there is a different environment. Nobody has discussed this. What is the environment in the home which is helping? So I was just studying world economics, what is happening on the students. You will be surprised. The total number of students worldwide is about 2 billion. Students, okay, learners, which are greater than 5 years. And out of that, one of the poor, five, there is a poor education. We keep on hearing this report that the class 4th or 5th student is not able to read English or Hindi, even of class 2nd, right? You might have heard this thing. And there is a ASER studies, which is the organization which does the survey every year and publishes it. The reason, they have found the two reasons for that. One, educated parents not available at home. Okay, so that is one reason. The second reason is, when we are talking of online and it gets an impetus, that computer literate or literate you know, father or mother is not there, parents are not there. So these two definitely has impact even in the online learning. See, when you're young, young students are not easy to handle by from the parents' point of view, okay, and they are full of energy. So it is very difficult for them to have an online session the way any other student can go through.
Sir, Nandini is also adding one point here that about what you were saying, that how can the learning of backbenchers and slow learners can be facilitated to online education, as faculties are not only enablers for learning, they play a role of mentor and a lot of time provide helping hand. Yeah, this is a very good point which you make.
Yeah.
That how so the backbenchers are going to...
Yeah, so actually education per se, and I think very good point by Nandini, the reason is education, there is always a conflict. How do you handle the class with the speed of slow learner or the speed of fast learner or the middle path? So most of the people adopt middle path because that is okay for fast learner also and hopefully okay for the slow learner. But you need special classes for slow learners. Definitely, and that some schools have curriculums based on that they provide workbooks for slow learners in a separate way. I know there is a Millennium Schools of Change which does that kind of learning to the slow learners. Yes.
I feel that there is, because of these 2 billion people and because of the situation, there is a lot of scope for digital transformation in the educational sector. And yes. Lot of companies are still, lot of schools, and we work with a lot of schools. You know, you're aware of that. We have worked with a lot of schools. We have worked with you also in the past. We have worked with a lot of chains. I still feel that some of these chains are still not getting and understanding that probably either this will replace, or in the best case scenario, it will be a definite assistance to the school teaching model, which is a physical teaching model. So this is not kind of going to go away. And schools will have to spend substantial amount of resources behind creating a complete digital teaching infrastructure at a global level. And this might be the competitive advantage for some of the school chains which started right now. And that can be in multiple things. That can be in the area of, you know, right from, as I talk about this thing, creating the right kind of digital technology, creating the right kind of digital marketing, and then creating the right kind of digital analytics, and hence kind of completing the whole spectrum. Basically having a very good website app, having teachers in the background who understand things like virtual reality, all of that, and are trained on that, deliver their classes through that, are able to access student performance digitally, moving ahead, you know, getting students, getting new enrollments completely through digital marketing, and finally measuring through digital analytics what is happening in the entire spectrum. Now, when you combine these three things, then what you start seeing is a very robust digital delivery of education. And as we have got a very, very large number of students, it becomes even more important. And you know, a lot of these students, you know, cannot even afford. So you know, I see it more as a boon that people who are not able to afford quality education as of now, especially in the early years and growing up years, will have a chance to kind of get very, very, very high quality education, because now a system has been created where all the elements of the education, or at least 80% of the elements of the education, there is a possibility to deliver them digitally. And Webwisdom as a company kind of works in that area, and we work with a lot of school chains to exactly enable that. I'll just add a bit of a question there. Do you think when you are funding schools, would you like to fund a chain which has got digital capabilities to deliver education consistently, or would it not be a factor?
So very good question. I think going forward, this will become one part of it. Why? Because even fee, getting fee on time will become part of it. Like if you remember about 10 years back when the smart classes came into the schools, So this became a kind of a fad that unless you have a parent used to ask, do you have a smart class at your school? If yes, then only they will take admissions. So I think now the smarter parents will start asking this question to the school, whether you have an online learning management system or not, because they know once in a while, there will be a chance that where the school will get closed for whatever reason. It can be floods, it can be earthquake, it can be anything today, tomorrow. So any natural calamity can force things to happen and the kind of situation now we are going through. So one, that is there. Second, to tell you and what you were saying, I have a disruptive idea that there can be a situation where the best of your physics teacher will be hired by the government and they will be beamed to the whole schools of government schools in their classrooms. Okay. And you're getting from the suppose the best actor in country is Amitabh Bachchan. So Amitabh Bachchan teaching how to do acting in the class, you know, it has a huge different flavor versus somebody who is just trying to learn the subject and then trying to teach in a government school. So similarly, there can be a very disruptive way of learning in the government schools, definitely. Private schools, how it will have impact, it has to be seen. But I see what you were saying to the poor kids. I think this will be a boon where the government will bring in methodology to beam this into the classrooms of the schools, because they have, where is the biggest expense going in education? You will be surprised. We do spend of about 3% to GDP. Okay. And it is hardly some 75,000 crores. Okay. Most of this money goes into paying education salaries. So if I have this kind of environment where I have even statewide boards, where I have statewide good teachers, and I relay this all across in the classroom beam through it, what will happen? I will save huge cost. And today, huge paucity of teachers is the main thing. Okay. So what you are saying is it can make a huge difference to the education per se in the country if we adopt this in the government schools first. And then slowly it will have roll off into the because in private schools, parents are able to afford the fees of teachers, you know, so that may continue because physical impact is definitely better than the online impact. Let's be clear on that function, especially in the schools. In a higher education or skilling, I think there we can have a huge replacement happening. So some of the colleges will convert into a classrooms of digital classrooms. So where a good teacher of a particular skill can beam through all across the colleges, and you will get the same guy teaching all across the colleges. So you in a higher education, I feel there can be a huge difference in the way online teaching will have. And slowly you will. And also there is always paucity of good teachers. You know that in colleges. So I think in the government schools, there will be huge impact. And on the higher education and skilling, it will have a huge impact.
So one question is coming from Devendra again. Do you think that homeschooling option should also be available in India like other countries? Currently, it is not a legal or approved system in India. What's your
say? I think soon it will come. The way we are progressing, I think government will be very happy to have kids going through the school. I know in foreign countries there are this system where they allow the student to go through homeschooling, and you have to build a parameter to see how you can upgrade the kid from one class to the second class. And if you have some system of knowledge, why not? I think it is possible. Will it come soon? Maybe it may take a few years, but definitely we'll move as the IT technology improves more and more. Like government is coming with the TV. Now they are saying we are relaying the TV. So if that is a system, along with that, some tests are given to the kids that he has understood basics. Who knows? You may find it coming very soon. Quite possible.
See, Suraj, the rigidity in the education system now is becoming a lot more fluid. Okay, so you know all of these things which I'm seeing now. I see that there is like this paradigm shift where a student can get educated in any manner he wants. and you know, in any form he wants, and he can get all the assistance also which he wants. Earlier, the way to get education was pretty straightforward. You have to go to a school, you have to go to a college, you have to go to, you know, a coaching center, all of that. And there was no kind of what you call, different people could not be taught differently because there was no way available. But with the digital transformation which is happening, and with, you know, this pandemic, now it is, you know, this force is coming much, much more stronger. So how I see is that, you know, a homeschooling option is actually a direct taking it ahead that online learning management system can be applied to a homeschooling system pretty naturally. It's like a very natural extension of the whole thing. It's like a direct extension of the whole thing. Now, so a student, you know, might, you know, his or her parents might be able to teach most of the stuff. But for some of the things like testing, some of the things like, you know, benchmarking the student with other students in the same area, other students at a national level, even in different classes. Earlier, there was no kind of an easy way of doing that. But now all of that can be modulized. So a school can, you know, come up with a section that, you know what, people who want to come and study in my premises can do that. People who want to kind of study from the homes completely can do that. People who do not want to study but only want to take tests with us can do that. And all of that can be, you know, digital modules which can be made available to everyone. And their benchmarking, and, you know, they can then have these, teacher interactions if they want. So all kinds of finer nuances will start kind of coming into play. And, you know, while growing up, I wanted some of these things when, you know, I was kind of studying in schools and, you know, colleges. Now, but I feel that the current generation would have a lot of these available. How they play out in the whole, economics, and, you know, how the economics of this plays out, that is to be seen. How quickly this transformation happens, again, that is to be seen. But I think we are on the path towards that because of digital transformation.
Yeah, and I think the point is, one important thing from the college point of view, skills point of view, will be how the employer looks at it. Because Coursera is already there and it is very popular. But still, employers, I was just talking to my brother in US, and the people who graduate on online courses, the employers don't give that much of weightage currently. So I think over the period of time, employers have to give weightage to these courses. And once that is there, then automatically whole things is changed. And it is going to change immediately, because Google and Facebook has already started this, that now you can work from home. They have closed their offices till 2021. What they are saying is, I can now recruit people across the world, anywhere, who has got access to the laptop or a tab, okay, and who has a skill set. So I don't need that guy has to be American. You know, today, even whatever Google may say, still 67% of their team is from America. So tomorrow they need not have to have. You may find Chinese, Indian, Indonesians, all these guys are full of Google in the Google. Because they are good in that technology skills. So suddenly, once this changes, the employer changes, and they are open to hire people on the basis of the skills what they have got, rather than degrees what they have had. Have I got a physical degree from Harvard, or it doesn't matter, I have got a skill, I pass the test, so I get into your company. If that kind of modular thing, especially it will start from IT field, I feel. And slowly it will percolate to the other fields also. That's my view on that.
But my point here is that, how are you correlating is this with, because what you guys are talking about a digital transformation, online, e-learning, everything, okay? But that is only 20% of our India. 80% is definitely tier 2 and rural areas, okay? So how are we correlating this thing? Because that is more critical. School is the foundation of anyone's life, okay? So are we, matlab wahan pe kya hamare paas itni sari facilities, because wo correlation to kahin dikhai nahi pad raha, then how are we going to do that? Because so, that is the question which is very critical, and a question is also coming from Abhishek also, and he is also saying the same thing, that how e-learning will be done in rural and how a school will be ready to teach e-learning.
So I think currently it may not be available. First, telecom infrastructure is well positioned currently. So that is a good thing about it. We have got a good infrastructure of telecom. And today there are 120 crores of mobile sets available in the country, point number one. Point number two, in telecom is going to improve. So it is not standing. We are going to get 5G soon, okay? Which means high speed and all. So what will happen as we get into 5G kind of technology, suddenly things will improve big time. It's said that what 4G is, it is 10 times. So it may take 2 to 3 times, 2 to 3 years to get this to this kind of technology. And slowly the adoption rate of younger population, if you see your younger son or younger daughter, they are much attuned to the, they know more features of phone than you and me knows, okay? So the younger population having adoption of technology is faster, okay? So these two factors, having technology and adoption of technology by the younger kids is going to be faster. So you will see that schools getting transformed over the period of time, because online will become a part of the game. You will be surprised that tier two cities school also has Wi-Fi in their schools, you know. So earlier there was an era when there was no email available in the schools. I remember that era 10 years back. There were many schools, they didn't have email. And I was surprised that is 10 years is when we had a good telecom density. But today everybody has email, okay. Everybody has access to the mail and they have access to the WhatsApp also. Okay, in the group. So normally every school you will see there is a WhatsApp group of the teachers or teacher and the student, and there is a apps available for the bus, you know, bus, whether the bus is coming or not, these apps are available. So that means the technology is getting embedded. Yes, the question is timeline, whether is it going to happen in the next 2 years or it will take another 6-7 years. That is a question we will have to answer. My personal view is that it is a matter of 3 to 4 years that you will see a lot of tier two cities getting into converted, and then slowly it will go to tier three, tier four. So this will become like today TV or TV is there in almost all the homes. We have 33 crore population of TVs, okay? So which was not there 10 years back. So slowly, same way your Skynet and all this are available at home. So slowly this will also progress, personally, I feel.
I also do not have any doubts about it, Suraj. I feel that, you know, the rural penetration with the amount of handsets which are being procured, most of the new handsets are in the smartphone category. The telecom rates are among the cheapest in the world. Almost everybody, you know, every household either has a phone or has an access to a phone. So like somebody, you know, in the next household having a phone. So even in the rural sector now, and this is kind of happening across classes also. So phone is becoming like a necessity. The other big challenge which I see is the whole electricity part of it. Okay, which is the challenge? I think that's that, you know. So telecom to a large degree will be solved. I feel that the larger challenge will come in the form of electricity. But government is adding capacity. So I think you know, we are very well positioned to kind of take advantage of that. A few challenges which Harpreet pointed out there, and I agree with that. Learning from a mobile or a desktop also requires assistance from your parents. Now this is where the tricky part is, okay? Because when you are in the physical space, the teacher looks after you. He makes sure that, you know, he's tough on you, he will talk nicely to you, he will do a lot of things, and he will kind of make sure that you are learning. In the bigger challenge which I see is not actually on the infrastructure side on this. The bigger challenge I see is that the contribution which the parents can make towards, you know, making a child learn. I think that's where a bit of a discovery and a bit of a journey kind of needs to happen, and that may take time. That may take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years. But these are some of my views on that. That, you know, how it may happen.
Yeah, thanks, Amardeep. So we are just going to take the last question of tonight's show. Okay, This is from Mr. Pawan. Do you think online classes can provide competitive environment that we had in school colleges, because it's very much required to keep students motivated?
Yes, sir. I agree. I think Pawan Kumar has touched the right chord. Today, kids are very, very happy to go online, and they feel quite excited with that. And personally, I feel you will see that. That's why I said that now onwards, personally, I feel this year onwards, that means right from the June onwards, whenever a parent will go to the school, they will ask this question: do you have online learning management system? Do you have online system? And slowly, this will put pressure on the owners. So we have done in the last 1 month, we would have done 700 demonstrations, Amardeep, to the schools, 700 schools, okay, for online management system. And the adoption rate has been poor, okay? I can tell you that. Personally, they are all waiting. You know, they are not saying that we will not go for it. They are waiting where the government is taking and what is the parents going to say. Once parents start, and it is not expensive. So the point is, they are just watching and saying that what parents have to say and what government is saying, then they will adopt. So I think they are sitting on the edge. So I think this year is going to be transformational for online education in the country. And maybe end of the March 2021, when we will have a view, that will give us a view how the country has adopted online education per se, especially in tier one and metros and tier two cities. And then we will talk of whole India. But if there is a huge adoption in metro and tier one, that is a first step, I would say.
Absolutely. Then, then it trickles down.
Then it is a matter of time. It will percolate to the tier two, tier three cities.
I think one of the larger challenges is that while online education may be adopted as a supplementary channel for education, the point that now it is becoming the main channel, and the certificate is going to come from online school. So, you know, like a 12th class or 10th class certificate coming from an online school or the online wing of a school, I think the acceptance of that is a bit tricky, you know, and, you know, that's how I think where the both psychology and, you know, the whole environment and ecosystem has to play a role.
So it will become physical, not digital. So it is what is a combination of digital and physical, which is what is called physical. So we will go through a physical school rather than digital or physical school only. I think we will have mixed that.
I agree.
Okay. I think we are out of time, running out of time now. It's more than 1 hour 10 minutes now. So I just want, it's a wonderful discussion and very beautiful insights came from you, Harpreet and Amardeep. Okay, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Might be my video is also troubling. So thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much, viewers, for all of your questions. And you can also write it to me in the comment section, and that will be later on answered. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for tonight.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Suraj. Thank you, Amardeep. Thank you, all the viewers. Thank you. Bye-bye.